that Allah, parentheses God, appeared in the person of Master W. Fard Muhammad. July 1930, the long-awaited Messiah of the Christians and the Mahdi of the Muslims. Now, I think that would be controversial among the mainstream Muslims. Could you understand or clarify these statements that God appeared in the person of Fard in Detroit?
First of all, the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, said to all of us in his hadith that the Mahdi would come out of his family, and the whole Muslim world is expecting Mahdi, number one. The Muslim world also is expecting the return of Jesus coming with Mahdi. The third point is the Shiite Muslims are looking for the hidden Imam or the 12th Imam, which is called Imam Mahdi. And they thought that Ayatollah Khomeini was that Imam, but from his own lips, he said he was not Mahdi. Now, why does the Muslim Ummah need a Mahdi? The Mahdi is a guide.
Black activist groups, including Al Sharpton's National Action Network, also Black Lives Matter, and the New Black Panther Party, now organizing a protest in support of and in defense of the controversial leader of the Nation of Islam, Louis Farrakhan. The groups are protesting a congressional resolution condemning Farrakhan. With me now, Harvard Law Professor Alan Dershowitz. First of all, Professor, there are some other comments made by Farrakhan. Here's one of them. The Jews talk about never again. You cannot say never again to God, because when he puts you in the oven, you're in one indeed. He also said the Jews have control over those agencies of government. He also said this: when a woman does not know how to cook and the right foods to cook, she's preparing death for herself, her husband, and her children. Professor, Democrats like Maxine Waters, Al Green, Keith Ellison, they also have links to Farrakhan. What's going on here?
Well, first of all, Farrakhan is not only an anti-Semite, he's anti-white, he's anti-woman, he's anti-gay. He's anti-everything decent in this country.
Now, if you were a Jewish American watching that, your reference to what you call the Holocaust, suggesting whether there was a Holocaust, and the whole reference to big Jews and little Jews, and the emphasis you use, why would you say that's anti-Semitic? The question is it true? If it is true, then it is not anti-Semitic, it is true. My problem with the Jewish community is that most of the people feel, or the Jewish people feel, that if you criticize any act of Jews, that is anti-Semitic. If I criticize Arabs, if I criticize the government of the United States, if I criticize white people or my own black people, I'm not considered anti-black, anti-Arab. Why should anybody who criticizes Jewish behavior that ill affects black people and their pursuit of happiness be considered anti-Semitic? Last week, Orthodox Jews made the statement that Reform and conservative Jews are off the page of Judaism. I saw it not in the New York Times, but I saw it in the Chicago papers, just a little writing, but nobody called them anti-Semitic. But if I said that Reform Jews or conservative Jews or those that do not follow the laws, commandments, and statutes given by God to the prophets of Israel are not really Jews, then I'm considered anti-Semitic. I am not anti-Semitic. I do not hate Jewish people. I hate actions of any people, including my own, that are evil and are obstructive to justice, freedom.
Applaud this covenant, but it demonstrates our impotence. Because in many of the chapters, it keeps going back to not only what we do, but really, we start looking to the same life that has continued to promise but never fulfill. And that's why God said, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive your sins and heal your land. So don't look to them, look to God, look to yourself. Break your covenant with hell and death, then make a covenant with Black America, and let's help implement a roadmap that will free us, and the whites that will be freed can be freed by this. The Mexicans, the Hispanics can be freed by this roadmap. We are a universal people. But those at the top, they're on their way to hell. And if I got any power, I want to push them into hell as fast as I can. We are a full nation now, and we gotta stop thinking like Negroes and colored people and shines and ham bones, and start thinking like free men and women who don't want to live on a plantation no more. I gotta go. Here's what I see, respectfully. Frederick Douglass said, power concedes nothing without a demand. But power won't even concede to a demand if the demand is coming from a weak constituency that looks like they've lost their testicular fortitude. Preacher too. But listen, family, listen. The generational gap is serious. But it's written of in Scripture. When Moses gathered the people in the wilderness, he spied the promised land. But there were some giants in the promised land. And the people were asked, go in, we with you. They said, wait a minute, God. We would go, but the giants are there. They had no faith that they could take the land from the giants. So what did God say? Okay, you wander in the wilderness till you die out. And I will take your children. And they will inhabit the promised land. Martin Luther King said, I've been to the mountaintop. I have seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but we as a people will get there when we separate from a pharaohic idea of mental slavery. Our children, listen. Our children cannot eat at the table of illusion and hypocrisy. Most of us who have access, who have wealth, who have quote-unquote positions, we are like mannequins in the shopping mall of democracy. When you go to the shopping mall, you see the mannequin. Is dressed in what you would like to buy. The mannequin can't talk. The mannequin can't walk. We got black people in power, but they don't have power. We got black people with money.
giants, but in the company of their white counterparts, they are midgets. Now, if we want to get where we want to go, we can't focus on the house that has rejected us and our fathers for 400 years. We have to now focus on ourselves. Now follow this and I'm out of here. Follow this. President Bush, bless his heart. Is worried about weapons of mass destruction. No dark nation should have a weapon of mass destruction. They have a fear. France got it. England got it. I think Germany may have something. South Africa has it. Israel has it. These are the former, some of them the former colonial masters. They have the right to have it, but don't give it to a darker power. We're worried about China has it. India has it. Lord have mercy. Pakistan got it. Korea was the axis of evil. Now Korea said, well, we got it. All of a sudden they fell off the screen. It's now Iran and Iraq. Well, if they are so afraid of weapons, of mass destruction, my teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, said, our unity is more powerful than an atomic or hydrogen bomb. That's the one thing we have never tried. We've kneeled in, crawled in, prayed in, lied in, slept in, but still, we are out. If you want to get what you want, we gotta start with a contract with us. A contract, a covenant with us. We in leadership make a covenant with your people that you will never sell them out. We as leaders.
And he told me straight up, he said, brother, some of my people jumped all over me just for having you in the church at the Tavis Smiley State of Black America. He says, I won't be able to be with you with the million man march celebration. I said, I understand, Bishop Long. May God bless you. I called Creflo Dollar, another great pastor. And I've been trying to get an appointment with Bishop T.D. Jakes. And every time it was arranged, for some reason, it never happened. What have I done that people should hate Farrakhan? Well, they say he's just not a Christian. Oh, of course I am. Of course I am. Some pastors even get jealous the way I preach. But they don't want to walk with me, but they will let a Jewish person stand up in their church who don't believe in Jesus at all. So really, you bow to money. You bow to their power of wealth and organization. They ain't got nothing to do with Jesus. But you use that as an excuse to stay away from me. Are you really a Christian? Or are you the people of Satan masquerading in the name of Christ?
Come on, brother, make it plain. Ask that again. Look here, Muslims. Ain't nobody came after you. Don't you ever forget that.
That's right.
Do you think that Prophet Muhammad would be pleased when your mission is to spread the Quran to the ends of the earth? Who brought the Quran to us? You didn't bring us no damn book. You didn't do a damn thing for us. You walked over us. You walked by us. You never invited us to your mosque. Damn self-righteous hypocrite.
But when Elijah Muhammad began talking to us, all of a sudden you become interested because he ain't teaching us the right Islam.
What is the right Islam? To be like you? What is the right Islam? You're the real Muslims. But President Clinton can butt your butt. And your kings and your rulers bow down like little sissies. What is the real Islam? When our Muslim brothers who are white in Bosnia, women being raped, Muslim children being killed, and the Muslim world stands by like a group of faggots because the United Nations said you can't give weapons to your own brother to fight to defend his own land. You gonna tell me what a real Muslim is? What is a real Muslim? One who makes a lot? A damn devil could bow down, jackass. Devils can prostrate. Devils can make sajda. That don't mean you're a Muslim because you pray like one. A Muslim is what a Muslim does. Your whole life should be devoted in service to Allah. And don't tell me it's just prayer and fasting during the month of Ramadan and paying a little jive zakat. God damn it, it's going out, getting the people in the mud and freeing a slave and lifting your people. And if you're not doing that, don't talk to me about what a true Muslim is. You're nothing but a damn hypocrite. Farrakhan don't have the right Islam. Farrakhan is a deceiver. Farrakhan's teaching is like Kool-Aid, laced with cyanide. You're just a damn envious nigga. You can't stand to see crowds come out to hear Farrakhan while you can't draw flies if you were manure. You're upset because God has put it in the hearts of black people to love Farrakhan. They don't want your kind of Islam. They don't want no damn religion that make a faggot out of them. They don't want a religion that's gonna make them into an Arab. I ain't no Arab. God damn it, and don't try to make me one. I'm a black man. Excuse me. But ain't nothing in here but men. And we having a man's talk tonight.
tell me I accepted an Arab religion. No, I didn't. I accepted the nature in which I'm created. Before there was a man named Muhammad, before there was a man named Abraham, I was. I'm a black man. I'm the original man. I was in the beginning. So look, they ain't gonna give you no power. Power is something that comes from God, and you accepting knowledge. When you accept knowledge and learn to love who God made you, with your kinky hair and your black face and your thick lips and your broad nose, don't try to be made in the image of nobody else. God knew what he was doing. The Quran said the first man was called Adam. The Quran says that Allah created him out of black mud and fashioned him into shape. Now go and tell me I'm a racist. That makes you strange. So you don't have to be a nigga no more. So you gonna act like you somebody else with an affected accent. Assalamu alaikum, alhamdulillah. Why the hell don't you be yourself? You can speak Arabic. You don't have to have an affected speech because you study the Quran. Quran ain't trying to make you an Arab. They're trying to make you a righteous man and a righteous woman. You don't use it like no damn cover. You put it on and you take it off and hang it up in your closet. You're a Muslim from early morning till you lay down in your bed, and you sleep a Muslim, and you wake up a Muslim, and you die a Muslim, because you live the life of a Muslim. All these teachers from all over the world coming to make you into them. I see you dressing like a Pakistani. They're good Muslims, but you ain't Pakistani.
That's right, brother. That's right.
You got good Muslims who are Arabs, but you're not an Arab. You don't have to dress in their national dress to be a Muslim. I gotta go and show them. So when I go to Mecca, I gotta go there and show them that I'm trying to be one of them. Hell no. I go there with my bow tie on. But what does the bow tie mean? Mean I grew up in hell. I grew up in America. My natural dress is a robe. But I don't speak the language of a stranger. My people are in hell and I'm in hell with them. And I gotta speak the language that they understand. I come to them all robed up and dude it up. They say, who the hell is this coming here? So I come to them looking like their brother. Oh, well, he got a suit on. Damn, that's a nice suit. he got on a nice pair of shoes, too, boy. Nigga sharp. It's not what I got on. It's what I got in.
Come on! Sing a song. Here's what I want you to sing. Well, they don't even have to give you the song. You're writing them today. That are so low down and funky. You have become purveyors of filth. You have become the animals of the world that they parade on MTV. society. You parade your nakedness before the entire world with a string up your behind. Cover of our album. What kind of man are we?